welcome this morning to Cornerstone. We're so glad you're here. Please stand with us, and we'll join the choir on that second verse, "When Darkness Fails."
When darkness fails, His lovely face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Standing for a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, as we begin this morning service, we ask in a very special way that your power be present, that your hand would be upon Pastor as he breaks your word to us, your hand would be on our hearts as we listen so that we could absorb and know what you want us to do. We pray for those that be here struggling for any reason today, that you would be their comfort, their strength, their help. We pray for the soul that needs to know Jesus Christ as Savior, that they would come today and put their faith and trust in Him. We just ask your blessing now upon all that we do, that Christ would be exalted and lifted up. And we give you again thanks in the name of our Savior Jesus. Amen.
All right, we'll be in Psalm 409, "I Know Whom I Have Believing."
I know not why God's wondrous grace to me He hath made known, nor why unworthy Christ in love redeemed me for His own. But I know whom I have believed in, and am persuaded
hands, please.
Please join us on the fourth verse.
No, not when my Lord may come at night or noonday fair, nor if I walk the vale with him or meet him in the air. But I know whom I am believing and am persuaded.
Be seated.
All right. Well, good morning. Welcome to Cornerstone Baptist Church. We're so glad that you're here, and we have some birthdays, and they're going to love me for doing this, but I'm your pastor, okay? I have to do this. I have to embarrass you every now and then. If I could get somebody with young, fresh legs, Joshua, come here, all right? All right, so October 1st, we had a birthday. Mrs. McGinnis. Is Miss McGinnis here? In the back, all right? And then Brian West. Where are you at, Brian? Brian West, your birthday is October 5th.
Yeah.
We'll come to you, okay? We'll come to you. And then David Ledbetter. Is David Ledbetter here? David Ledbetter, October the 6th. And then Mrs. Pointer. Is Mrs. Sherry Pointer here? Joni Pointer, October the 6th. So if you could raise your hand, we'll get that birthday card to you. And then I'm going to ask Brother Tar to come up and lead us in happy birthday. Should we make them stand on their birthday?
Yeah.
All right. This is America. We voted. You must stand. Okay? If it's your birthday, please stand. And Brother Tar, come lead us in happy birthday. What? We're getting pointed at.
Wednesday,
Mrs. Haig is her birthday. So, Mrs. Haig, stand too. Stand too. And we're going to have Brother Tar lead us in happy birthday.
All right. When we get down to the part where we normally say the name, we'll say God bless you. All right? Everybody ready?
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Give him a hand, give him a hand. All right, I was going to sing the part to all the ladies, how old are you? But my mom taught me better, so we're not going to do that, all right? So good to see you here this morning. We have a couple announcements here. There's a ladies' activity this Saturday, and if you're interested, please see Mrs. Goodner for that. And I want to see her sign her own name while she signed others. How do you sign Miss Goodner? I don't know sign language. She probably did it. But see Mrs. Goodner for more information about the ladies' activity this Saturday. It's going to be a lot of fun. Also, men's prayer breakfast. It will be October the 8th at 9 a.m., I want to encourage all the men to come out for that, and we'll have a good time of fellowship and breakfast and prayer, and it'll be a good time. Tonight, after the service tonight, there's going to be a church volleyball activity, so everybody that's interested can come out and play, and it'll be a good time there. If you have any questions, please see Brother Ivan, and he'll get you some more information. If you're interested in giving towards the special Anniversary Sunday offering that we took on Anniversary Sunday, it's for a church van, and you can still give towards that. Just make a notation on your tithe envelope of church van, and they'll make sure it gets there. Thank you so much for everybody that's given towards that. We've raised about $1,300 for that, and it'll be used for the church, the school, different activities, and there's no CDL required, so anyone that's on the insurance can drive that. So please be in prayer for that. And then also the Team Fall Bash. If the sign-up sheet's on the back table in the lobby. If you're interested, that'll be October 15th. If you want to donate some things toward that, you can do that, or donate your time in volunteering and serving for that. It's back there. Let's see here. Marriage Retreat sign-up sheet's in the back in the lobby. Quite a few people have already signed up. There's plenty of space, so make sure you sign up for the Marriage Retreat. That'll be February 17th and 18th. It'll be a great time, great trip together as married couples, and we're looking forward to that. Now, I want to spend just a few minutes on this. We're having a church fall festival, family fall festival, that is different than what the teens are doing. The teens is geared more towards reaching the teenagers in our community. The fall festival we're doing is for everybody, families, kids, everybody in the community, and that's going to be October 29th from 5 to 8 p.m., And we also need some people to help volunteer for the game booths and all of that. So please stop by and sign up on the table. There's also flyers for the Fall Festival. It has all the information on there. On the back, it even has, like, everything is free, but we're going to have a concession stand where we sell chili and hot dogs and things. All of the proceeds, if you would just take the money that you were going to spend at McDonald's and take it and spend it in the concession stand, all the proceeds from that are going to go towards the church van as well. So please get the word out. Invite everybody you can. We're going to have a chili cook-off competition, and the winner will get $50 for the prize, and I'll be a judge. So I love chili. And we also need judges back there. So if you love chili like me, we also need some impartial judges for the chili cook-off contest. There's going to be game booths and a whole bunch of fun stuff. So make sure that you make plans to join us for that. And you will see on the flyer that we're advertising live music, okay? There's also going to be the, I don't know what they call themselves. Where are you at? Who's in that group? Is Ms. Shake here? The bluegrass... Mr. Pete, so the Pointer Bluegrass group is going to be performing for us, and they'll have the, they got a fiddle, they have a banjo, they have a guitar. It's going to be a lot of fun. They're going to be performing for us, playing for us. It's going to be great. So get the word out for it. We'll have a great time as a church family. There's also going to be a salvation station, all right? There's going to be a booth set up where people that stop by will be given the clear presentation of the gospel. So we're going to need people to work the Salvation Station and just be in prayer for people that are there to get more than just chili and a good time, but also get the plan of salvation and that we have souls be saved. So please be in prayer for that, and look forward to it when it comes.
All right, let's pray for the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for allowing us to come together and to worship your name, Lord. Lord, as we come to the time of the service to give back to you, Lord, let us give back cheerfully, and let all the monies come in and go for your work to reach the Lawrence community and around the world the gospel, that many will come to a saving knowledge of you. We thank you and praise you in your son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please stand with me. Let's sing song number 306, Jesus Saves.
We have heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news to every land, climb the steeps and cross the waves. Onward is our Lord's command, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Wafted on the rolling tide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Tell to sinners far and wide, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Salvation of the sea, and the backy ocean caves, earth shall keep her jubilee. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing above the battle strife, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. By his death and blessed life. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Sing it softly through the gloom when the heart for mercy craves. Sing in triumph for the tomb. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Junior Church, you may be dismissed. Let's sing the song, verse number 4, song number 306.
Give the winds a mighty voice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nations now rejoice. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free. Highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Good singing. You may be seated. Right before the message, Josh and Allie will sing.
I once was lost in sin's dark valley, drowning in life's angry seas, going down, no one to help me, but Jesus' love has lifted me.
Thank you so much for that special, and I did not know that stand could go that high. Did you know it went that high? I think Josh is the only one in this church that could actually stand behind Brother Mead's pulpit and not look like this, okay, in his classroom. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you'll have to go stop by and see what I'm talking about. But good to see you here this morning, and I'm looking forward to spending time in God's Word with you tonight, or this morning. And if you have your Bibles, turn with me to John chapter 4. John chapter 4, and we'll read quite a few verses in the text. It's so good to pass up. And John chapter 4, beginning in verse number 1. John chapter 4, verse number 1. Thank you for praying for the teachers' convention. It was great. The preaching was just excellent from Scott Pauley and Dr. Redland. And it was just exactly what I needed to hear and encourage us to face the battles that there are in Christian education, but the battles are worth it. The battles are worth the hearts and minds of young people learning from a biblical worldview the different subjects that they're learning, and looking forward to what the Lord has for us the rest of the school year. John chapter 4 in verse number 1, if you found it, say amen. All right, John chapter 4 verse number 1, please read along with me as we read the scripture this morning. The Bible says, when therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee, and he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Jesus saith unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that sayest thou truly. The woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. And upon this came his disciples and marveled that he talked with the woman. Yet no man said, what seekest thou? Or why talkest thou with her? The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Now, you think you know where I'm going with this, but I don't think you know where I'm going with this. There's something in the text here that really stuck out to me, and I want to preach a message on this thought. Wearied by the well. Wearied by the well. Let's ask the Lord to bless our time together this morning. Dear the Father, thank you so much for the Word of God and what it shows us clearly. I pray that you would just speak to us through your Word. Lord, hide me behind the cross and help these folks, Lord, to hear from you. Speak to their hearts and help us to learn a truth from the text, Lord, where we can go to when we're weary. Where we can go to drink from when we need strength, when we need comfort, when we need peace, Lord. And Lord, if there's someone here that's not saved, I pray that they would go to the well and drink from the source that would give them water where they'll never thirst again, the everlasting water, the everlasting life that you're offering them this morning. I pray that you would speak to us, Lord. We'll give you all the praise and honor for it. And please be with all those people that have been affected by the hurricane, Lord, in Florida and Georgia, the Carolinas. Just please be with all those folks that woke up this morning realizing they've lost everything. People that have lost their homes, churches that have lost their church buildings, and they're wondering where they're going to gather this morning to worship you. Lord, I pray that you would be with all those folks that are dealing with this hurricane and the results from that. Please meet their needs and help them to experience your power and presence in a real way and work something truly remarkable through this hardship, Lord. And I pray that you would be with us, Lord. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Wearied by the well. There's so many incredible things going on in this chapter, so many different ways that we can go through this chapter, so many things that we could talk about, but I like to focus in on the group of people that were wearied in our story and what they did, where they went to get the help that they needed. Wearied by the well. Look at it with me in verse number one. We'll work our way verse by verse through this chapter. Verse number one, I'd like you to see three main things in our text, and then we'll make some application as we go. In verse number one, I believe we see the first main topic in our text being discussed, and it's this. We see the pettiness of the Pharisees. The pettiness of the Pharisees. Read it in verse number one with me if you would. When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than who? John. The pettiness that there was, Jesus being all-knowing, knew what was going on amongst the Pharisees, amongst the religious leaders. I mean, their world needed help. There were sinners that needed to be saved and told the truth. And what were they hung up on? They were hung up. They were arguing amongst themselves. They were dividing amongst themselves, choosing sides amongst themselves about who baptized more converts, Jesus or John. Is that something to draw a dividing line over? Who baptized more people? No, but these people were dividing themselves and a quarrel was coming up amongst themselves about who baptized more people, John or Jesus? This is the irony of the whole argument. Verse number two. In reality, it appears to me that Jesus wasn't even the one that baptized. It was his disciples, and yet they were making this big deal about baptism. In verse number two, the Bible says, though Jesus himself baptized what? Not. Baptized not, but his disciples. That just shows you how petty some people can be sometimes. The petty situations that come up and that end in just this great big fight and argument and division amongst God's people. I want to stop here. We're not going to talk about this. We could. I want to talk about this and just move on. Jesus gives us in verses 3 and 4 ways to deal with pettiness of others. There's things, circumstances that you and I can't control. We can't control what other people do and what other people make a big deal. We can't control the pettiness and the petty situations that come up in our life. But Jesus gives us in verses 3 and 4 a solution to dealing with petty problems. You ready for this? In verse 3, look at it. It says, he left Judea and departed again into Galilee. Do you know what that tells me? When they were sitting around there arguing about baptism, Jesus knew that there was work that needed to be done, and he departed to where he knew that they needed him. He didn't sit there and argue with those other petty arguments going on. He didn't feel necessary to vindicate his ministry, authenticate his ministry to everyone else, and debate with those people and their petty argument. You know what he did? He just departed. He departed. You know what he did? Number one, the answer to dealing with the pettiness of others is to distance yourself from the petty people. Just remove yourself from the situation. And then number two, how do you deal with the pettiness of others? The answer he gave us in verses 3 and 4 was devote yourself to what is most important. Devote yourself on what is most important. He didn't stand around there and argue with those people. He knew that there was people in Samaria, Samaritans, that needed to hear the gospel, and he focused his time, effort, and energy
where it was needed the most. And it wasn't arguing with petty people and their petty arguments. Verse number 4, we see something here. It says, and he must needs go through Samaria. Now, those of you that know the story, you know why he felt compelled to go through Samaria. But one would ask the question, why would he feel compelled to specifically go through Samaria? Well, the answer was there was a woman there, a woman of Samaria. And also, it was greater than just one woman of Samaria, but there was also an entire city of Samaritans that needed to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and to be saved. And that's why he felt compelled to go through Samaria. Now, this is interesting. In verse number 5, it says, then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Jesus and his disciples have just journeyed from where they were, left Judea, and now they're departing to Galilee, and now they've come to Sychar. I tried to research it out the best that I could. To the best of my ability, that's about 70 miles. 70 miles he traveled, he and his disciples traveled, either by foot or some type of animal. 70 miles. That's the equivalent of 2.5 days of steady, fast-paced traveling. Jesus finds himself at this well, and the Bible says, look at it with me in verse number 6. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being, what's the next word? Wearied. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the 6th hour. Why would Jesus weary himself with this journey? Why wouldn't he just break up the trip and take as much time as he needed and just pace himself? The Bible says he was weary, and I can just picture our Lord and Savior. Yes, he was God. Yes, he was God, and he was all-powerful God, but he was manifested in the flesh as man, and the man part of God was whipped. He was tired. He was tuckered out. He was gassed. Why would he sit there and weary himself with getting to this place the way that he did? Why did he seemingly try to get there? And there was a sense of urgency of why he got there when he was. He knew that there was someone there that needed him. And here it was in verse number 7. There cometh a woman of where? Samaria. This is important to note. Because that same journey, a Jew making that same journey that Jesus and his disciples made, would not have gone through Samaria. They would have purposely detoured around Samaria, adding time and length to their journey just so they wouldn't even have to cross paths with those dirty, rotten Samaritans. It leads to the next point, the thing that we see here in our text in verse number... Oh, before we get ahead of ourselves, let's look at it in verse number 7. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. Give me to drink. Now, you might be thinking something, well, that's pretty rude of Jesus, right? I mean, why would he just demand this woman here to just serve him and give him water? But to me, it's more than just him asking her to serve him. It's more meaningful than that. Just the fact that Jesus would speak to this Samaritan woman showed her that he was different than all the other Jews that might have interacted with the Samaritan. Just from him taking time to speak with this woman told her that he was different than all the other men culturally during that time. Women were not looked at as they are today. Special people, women that have a special meaningful purpose with their husband as a helpmeet. Culturally speaking, they weren't even really spoken to by men in public. And for Jesus to take time to speak to her as a woman and a Samaritan woman showed her that there was something different about this man named Jesus. When others would ostracize her, other folks from the town had ostracized her, treat her differently, wouldn't speak to her, would show her no compassion based off of what they knew about her that we're going to talk about here in a moment. Jesus was different, and she could tell it. In verse number 9, we see something sad, a sad reality of the day that they lived in. Look at him with me in verse number 9. The Bible says, "Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a what? Jew, asketh drink of me, which am a woman of" where? "Samaria. For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans." She was perplexed at the fact that he was a man talking to her as a woman. That he was a Jew talking to her as a Samaritan woman. And she asked herself, why are you asking me, a Samaritan, to get you water? Don't you know that Jews hate us? Don't you know that they despise us? They want no dealings, nothing to do with us? And that reveals to me that there was the second aspect of the story is the prejudice of that day. The prejudice of that day. The Jews were prejudiced against the Samaritans. And let me just say this, prejudice and racism is real. It's a real thing. It was real back then in the Bible days. It's a real thing that's happening today. And according to Scripture, there is no place for it. As a Bible-believing Christian, there is no place for prejudice or racism, because we understand that everybody was made in the image of God. And the Bible says that for God so loved the world and all the races and nationalities that make up the world. And as a Christian, a Bible-believing Christian, we should not have a prejudice bone in our bodies. But prejudice and racism was real back then. The Jews hated the Samaritans. They wouldn't speak to them and wanted nothing to do with them. In fact, they would not even walk in the same vicinity as them. So why would Jesus purposely take the most direct route to where he was, to where he was going, that would take them through this Samaria? Because he knew that those people needed to be saved, and he had a heart for them to be saved. And then we see in verses 10 through 28, we'll not take time to read all the verses, but in verses 10 through 28, we see this beautiful, inspiring, and life-changing conversation take place between Jesus and this woman of Samaria. But I want you to see the third aspect, and this is where we're going to spend our time. The third aspect of the story is the problems that the woman at the well had, the problems that she had. You've already seen in the text where it was referenced that people treated her differently. We already understand that Jews would treat her differently because she was a Samaritan, but I'm talking about the people, her neighbors, her Samaritans that were around her treated her differently. Why would they do that? Because they knew about the woman's background. They knew about the woman's history. And we've already read it, but let's go there, turn there quickly. Look at it with me in verse number 16. Jesus saith unto her, "Go call thy husband and come hither." The woman answered and said, "I have no husband." Jesus said unto her, "Thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had" how many? Five. "Thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband." That reveals to you the background of why her own Samaritans, had ostracized her. That gives us an indication of why it was that she, in the sixth hour of the day, was getting water. When everybody else in the town would probably go to the well in the coolness of the day, where it wouldn't be as tasking in the heat of the day, she was forced as being a scarlet lady of the town with the background that she had. She was forced in the hottest part of the day to get her water for her and her live-in partner. The sixth hour, according to Jewish time, would indicate it was about 12 o'clock. 12 o'clock, one of the hottest parts of the day. And Jesus wearied himself to get to this well at the time that day that he did, so he'd meet this woman that everyone else in her community had cast out and ostracized. Jesus had a heart for everybody, including this woman that had problems. The woman that, the person in our story had problems. This woman was wearied. Although in Scripture it does not say specifically, this woman was wearied. You can tell by the way that she talks and interacts and the phrases in our text that she was wearied spiritually. She was wearied emotionally. She was struggling with things. And she had no answer, no hope in sight for those things. But Christ had a heart and a burden for this woman with problems. And I want to say this, most of us in this room, hopefully nobody in this room, has any type of prejudice based on nationality, right? But I want to address the problem within, generally speaking, amongst Christians today. Let's not have a bone of prejudice in our body towards sinners either. We are called to give the gospel to the lost. Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost. A lot of people with this attitude of looking down our noses on people out there that don't have the benefit of a Holy Spirit living inside of them and changing them every day to reflect the image of Christ. Those sinners out there don't have that. And the only difference between them and us and you and I is the grace of God that we've already experienced for ourselves. And people that are high and mighty, that sit there high on their hog and high on the horse, look down on them and say, you know what? We don't want those type of people in our church. We don't want those people to come in and they're going to dirty the place. They're going to mess up our image. And Jesus Christ was not offended and worried about image or perspective. He had a heart to reach the lost, no matter what they look like, smelt like, or walk like, or talk like. Christians should not have a prejudiced bone in our bodies when we're trying to reach the lost with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The problem of the woman was a problem that's prevalent today. A lot of people living together before marriage, and that is wrong. That's sin according to Scripture. That doesn't mean that, we don't have a heart to reaching them with the gospel. Have a heart to showing them what the Word of God says and what it teaches and getting them to the place where they do what's right and they marry the way the Bible says and then start their life together the way that Christ intended for them to. I want you to see here this next 10 minutes. I want you to see specifically how this woman was wearied. How was she wearied? I mean, how can you look in this text and see that this woman was wearied? Well, I believe, number one, she was wearied by the well. She was wearied by the well. Literally, she was wearied with the well. It wasn't like she was weary and then she came to the well and then was there at the well wearied. That might have taken place, but literally the well. Think with me for a moment. What would that well remind her of every single day? I mean, this, let me paint a picture for you. This was the daily routine of this woman at the well. Every day she woke up, she was faced with the reality that because of her being ostracized and cast out from the community and shunned from the community, she had to take this heavy, heavy water pot, journey to the well carrying this water pot in the heat of the day when the sun is scorching down and shining down and beating down on her and weary herself, and then put the pot, attach it to the well and or the rope, and then lower the pot down, and then toil in pulling up the water pot at the well every single day, and then taking the heavy water pot and putting it upon herself and journeying back all during the heat of the day. Every single day she looked at that well and it reminded her that here we go again. That well was something that constantly reminded her of her sin and her actions and her lifestyle. It was just a thing that probably wearied her. Look at it in verse number 10. Look at it with me in verse number 10. The Bible says this, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee, what's the next two words? Living water. Jesus is using an analogy, an illustration that she's familiar with. She doing this whole drawing water thing knew a lot about drawing water in this well. She knew a lot about the well. She knew the proper way to draw water. She knew it was through the water pot. She knew the depth of the well. She even referenced later, the well is deep. Don't you know that it's too deep for you just to reach down there? Trust me, if anybody knows about this well, it's me. Every single day I have to weary myself with drawing water from this well. And here you are asking me about getting water, and then you're talking about water, living water? Don't you know how this whole well thing works? You come out here, take your pot, lower your pot, draw your pot, and go about your day. He was using something that this woman of Samaria was very familiar with, but she wasn't grasping that it wasn't physical water that he was offering her. Look at it, verse number 11. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing, what's the next three words? To draw with. You're going to see this phrase mentioned over and over again in our text, to draw or to draw with. She was hung up with him not having what was needed physically to draw water with. You have nothing to draw water with. Then she says, from whence then hast thou that living water? You can't physically draw it. So why are you? What water are you talking about? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus, trying to get through to her, verse number 13, answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into, what's the next two words? Everlasting life. The water that she had wearied herself with every single day drawing from that well was to sustain her physical life. And let me say this, the life that she was living was a miserable existence. Living in sin, and there's no hope, and there's no relationship with Jesus Christ, and there's no forgiveness, and every day you're reminded of the life that you're living. That life she was living was not really living. It was not really life. Going through the motions and burdened with her sin. She was being offered eternal life by Jesus Christ, and she was hung up with the physical water. Verse 15, it says this, the woman saith unto him, Sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither, what's the next two words? To draw. I believe, and you can disagree with me on this, I believe that in verse 15, she was just interested because he mentioned a way for her not to come to this well and have to go through the motions of drawing this water. She was not ready to receive Jesus Christ yet. She was interested in being alleviated, relieved from the task of drawing water. Yeah, give me whatever I need to get to no longer have to draw physically from this well. Then he said, Jesus saith unto her, go call thy husband. He realized before he could get her to the place of her receiving this gift of everlasting life, get her to the place of placing her faith and trust in him as her Savior, he first had to address the matter of her sin. He had to address the matter of her sin. And Jesus shows us a great balance of being just yet compassionate. Every time that he comes across a situation where people were caught in adultery or caught in sin, or in her case, caught in fornication, you know what he did? He addressed sin like he should righteously, but showed compassion towards the sinner. When those people were gathered around fixing to take up stones and stone the woman that was caught in adultery, you know what he did? Where are thine accusers? Go and continue to live in the sin that you were caught in. Is that what he said? No. He showed her compassion, but then he said, listen, go and what? Sin no more. He showed her compassion while addressing righteously the matter of sin. And we see the same situation play out here. He addresses the situation that she found herself. Where's your husband? And I don't know if all five of those husbands died. I don't know I don't know the situation behind it, but I know that she had five husbands, and now the one she's living with is not her husband. And that was definitely frowned upon in that day, and it's definitely against the Bible today. You know what he didn't do? He didn't shun her, didn't ostracize her. He wanted to reach her soul with the gospel, and he showed her compassion in trying to reach her. She was wearied by her sin, and that's shown here in her response, I have no husband. Can you imagine? Can you imagine her knowing the lifestyle she's living and this person ask her about her husband, knowing that she's living with a man that's not her husband? You can see just, I believe, the shame. I believe the embarrassment the way she asked. She creatively answered the question without lying. I have no husband. Yeah, I have no husband. He says, thou hast, what does it say? It says, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom now thou hast is not the husband, and that sayest thou truly. Then in verse number 19, the woman perceived, thou art a prophet. You know what? But you know what this did? This didn't do? Her sin didn't change Jesus' mind in helping her. In Romans chapter 5, verse 8, I'm reminded that, but God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In 1 Peter 3:18, the Bible says, For Christ also hath suffered suffered for sins, the just for the what? Unjust. Someone that's righteous dying for someone that's unrighteous. Someone that's perfect dying for sinful men like you and I. That he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. And here's the last thought here, and we're done. Look at verse number 20. And I want to speak on this. Verse number 20. The Bible says this. She answers then and says this. Our fathers, what's the next word? Worshipped. In this mountain. And ye say that in Jerusalem is a place where men ought to, what's the next word? Worship. Look at verse 21. Jesus saith unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. You know what we see? Number three, in verse number 20, we see the third problem that she had. She was not only wearied by the well, going through the motions of drawing water from the well. It reminded her being ostracized and shunned by the town. It reminded her of her sin. She was wearied by her sin, being confronted with her sin by the Lord Jesus Christ by the well that day. But number three, she was wearied by religion. She was wearied by religion. You know what she was doing? She was doing what many people today do when they're presented with the gospel. You know what she did? I mean, textbook form of what when you present someone with the gospel, she did exactly what you'll find other people do when they're presented with the gospel. She tries to sound spiritual. Look at verse number 19. I perceive that thou art a prophet. Talking to spiritual lingo. You're a prophet, aren't you? You're a man of God. I perceive you're a man of God. And if you try to give someone the gospel, and boy, they'll try to lay it on thick and try to tell you how spiritual they are, tell you about what church they attend, and you ask them, where is that? I don't know. Oh, who's your pastor? He's a good one. What's his name? I don't know. I couldn't tell you. They try to sound spiritual. What else did she do that other people, when presented the gospel, will do? Look at verse number 20. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Let me ask you a question. In the verses that we read, did Jesus say anything about worshiping in Jerusalem and not in the mountain? No. You know what she was doing? Classic tactic. Change the subject. You try to tell someone the gospel, I mean, you'll talk sports with them, you'll try to break the ice with them, oh, your yard's beautiful, yeah, I spent about $2,000 laying sod last year, and oh, yeah, oh, that's a nice truck, you have my dream truck, oh, you're a Hoosier fan, yeah, do you know for sure you're going to heaven? That's when things change, when you give them the gospel, and they change the subject, they'll try to divert the subject. I actually had never mind, it's too long of a story, we won't get sidetracked, but they try to change the subject. What else did she do? She tried to twist their words, twist the Savior's words. Ye say that in Jerusalem is where we ought to worship. Jesus never said anything like that. And yet she's taking something and changing the subject and trying to twist what he actually said. We never said it. To take the attention off of her sin. Then here's what she does. A lot of people do today. She tries to rely on her religion. She tries to rely on her religion. Worship. Kept bringing up worship. Being religious. And she knew some religious things. She knew that the Messiah was supposed to be coming. She knew that Jerusalem was the place where they went to worship. She knew that the forefathers of the faith, Jacob's well. She knew about the forefathers, Abraham and others. She knew a lot about religion. Yet she didn't know that Jesus Christ, she didn't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Worship, worship, worship. Let me ask you a question. Was she in any type of spiritual state to worship the Lord the way that he requires us to worship him? No, she was not. She was focusing on worship when she was a lost and in no spiritual state to even think about worshiping the Lord the way He wants us to. Because later in the text it says that God desires us to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Anything other than that is not right worship. It's not true worship. You know what she does? She represents, I believe, a majority of folks in this city, in our state, in our world today that know about religion yet have no relationship with Jesus Christ. She represents a lot of people that knew about the importance of worship. She knew about the forefathers. She knew about Jerusalem being the place of worship. She knew that the prophecy of the Messiah, yet she was lost because she didn't know Jesus Christ herself. The problem with our world today and a lot of people today is they have a false idea of worship. They have a false idea of worship. And Jesus Christ addresses it in verse 22. It says, ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship Him. God is a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. There's a lot of false worship going on out there. You have multitudes of people today that fill places of worship, and they go through motions of worship, and they truly aren't worshiping Christ, because the only people, according to Scripture, that can rightfully worship the Lord are those that understand we worship Him in truth, in spirit and in truth. In spirit, the only people that can worship the Lord in spirit are the ones that have the indwelling Holy Spirit of God living inside of their heart and soul, and that spirit communes with God's spirit, and that is the worship that's being referenced here. You have a lot of people in churches today that go through worship services, and they, like this woman, worship what they know not what. They have no idea about worship. They have no clue about who it is that they're even worshiping. Yet they go and they feast on the music in the atmosphere that feasts and feeds their flesh. And they leave flesh-filled and not spirit-filled and have no concept of what worship is. They have a false idea of what worship is. We have churches that are filled with lost, unregenerate, professing Christians that have no relationship with Christ and aren't truly Christians. They're lost. Verse 23 shows us this. But the hour cometh, and now is, when true worshipers. What is a true worshiper? Someone that worships in spirit and in truth. The spirit is referenced again. And the spirit, if we get that right, will always lead us to the truth. The spirit. You go into a service, and there is a spirit emphasis and not a flesh emphasis. A lot of churches today, I'm not going to speak for all of them, and they aren't wicked because they don't identically look like our church. Please don't misunderstand me. And we're independent, and they do whatever they felt led to do. But an average church today, the average worship service consists and looks like this. Entering in a darkened room where there's theater-style seats, where the platform and the back of the walls are blacked out, colored stage lights and laser show is going. There's no semblance of a church. There's no sacredness about it. Some person wearing a t-shirt, jeans, and skateboard shoes comes up and introduces a praise team with electric guitars, drum sets, and the praise team comes out and they play for about 40 minutes, and people come in from the lobby drinking their coffee that they bought from the coffee shop in the lobby, and they start singing songs that my four-year-old could write. Shallow, empty words, the same rhetoric repeated mindlessly over and over again. Fog machines are activated, the laser show begins. And then people caffeinate themselves through a horrible display of false worship. A guy or girl in the day that we live in now, a guy or a girl gets up that looks like they work at Hot Topic or Foot Locker. They walk up to the microphone with a bar stool there, and they sit down. They open up a modern translation from the Bible, and he finesses himself through a topical message of the Scripture while saying something for 20 minutes without saying anything for 20 minutes. People leave talking about how awesome the light show was and the music was, grab another coffee on their way out, and start their life not being experiencing the presence of God or worship. We get they leave not having felt the presence of God from the Word of God that confronts them like this woman at the well. Do you know what Jesus Christ didn't do? He could be compassionate without compromising truth. He could be compassionate without lowering his standard. He was compassionate, but yet he did not compromise what he believed. He didn't overlook her sin and just told her, you know what, just drink anyway of the living water. Just drink of the living water. Forget about mentioning sin. You know what he did? He didn't do what a lot of preachers do today and eliminate preaching what sin is and the consequences of it from his message to that woman at the well. Telling you what, we can learn a lot about the Savior and his message. At what point, Brother Morton, at what point did this woman get saved? Well, in verse 28, I believe, you disagree with me, in verse 28, look what it says. The woman then left her, what's the next word? Water pot. And went her way into that city and saith to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? What is the significance of the water pot? Her leaving the water pot. No, her leaving that water pot, to me, signified this. She was leaving what she had come to resent, what she was wearied over. She was leaving everything she knew about sustaining her own life, drawing water from that well. She left her trust and dependence in herself. She only trusted and depended on Jesus Christ. She was leaving what she thought she needed and gave everything to trusting in and depending on Jesus Christ. Well, how do you know she truly was born again? Well, to me, it's a good indicator. Verses 28 through 30, immediately after this encounter with Jesus Christ, her leaving her water pot, what's the Bible say she did? What's the Bible say that she began to devote her life towards doing? The woman then left her water pot and went her way into the what? City. And saith to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came unto him. Do you know what she did right after she had that encounter with Jesus Christ and he changed her life, forgave her of her sin and her past? She went to the same city that she probably was cast out of. She went to the very same people that had shunned her, ostracized her from society, and she began to tell them what Jesus had done for her. She began to share her story with those people that were gathered there. And I close my Bible, but look, John chapter 4, and look at it with me in verse number 39. John chapter 4, verse number 39, the Bible says this. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the who? Woman. Which testified, he told me all that ever I did. Do you know what she was telling everybody? He told me all that ever I did. Her message to her own city and her own Samaritans was a message of hope. Listen, if he could save me, knowing what he knew about me, there's no one in this city that this man named Jesus Christ, the Messiah, is not able to forgive and save. It was a message of hope, and that message of hope is what was a catalyst of reaching a majority of that city with the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's a hope that people's life can be better than what it is now. It's a message of hope that goes beyond their situation now. A fresh start, a do-over, a clean slate. That's what the message was. And disciples in verse 31, they were wearied. And they came with Jesus, but they immediately focused on getting physical sustenance and physical meat. And they were weary just like Jesus was, but Jesus is the one that stayed weary by the well. Why would Jesus stay there by the well and not get meat? Because he was focusing on a different type of meat. In verse number 32, it says this. The disciples came back. They were wondering, why on earth is he talking to this Samaritan woman? Who cares? We're hungry. Let's eat. Jesus, wait a second. You have meat? What? Look at verse number 32. But he said, Master, eat. And Jesus answered, but he said to them, I have meat to eat that ye know not of. Disciples wondered, hey, did you give him meat? I didn't give him meat. What's meat you talking about? And then he says, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Jesus was wearied. Jesus was hungry. Jesus was tired, just like the disciples were. But his focus while he was wearied was reaching others that are spiritually wearied by their sin, spiritual wearied by their past and their going through something just awful. Spiritually weary. In conclusion, let me have every head bowed, every eye closed. In conclusion, we'll end with this. Jesus had eaten spiritual meat, and the spiritual meat filled his weary soul. The answer today, if you're here today and you're weary, I mean you're physically, spiritually, emotionally tired, exhausted, worn out, what is the answer? What did Jesus do when he was physically weary, emotionally weary, and worn out? The answer to that is this, is to feed yourself spiritual meat of telling someone else about Jesus Christ. When you tell someone else about Jesus Christ and you share the gospel with them, you know what it'll do for you and I? It'll lift you up. It'll give you joy. It'll bring you closer to God. It'll encourage you. It'll rekindle that fire in your heart to reach in souls with the gospel. It will do our soul good. It did for Jesus. Even after the woman left, he still didn't want to eat because he was still relishing in what had happened to that Samaritan woman. To the person here, like the woman who's weary spiritually, who's empty inside, who's wearied by their sin and the consequences of it, who's spiritually thirsting for something in your life that nothing in this wicked world can satisfy and quench. Why don't you accept the living water that Jesus Christ offers you this morning? Why don't you accept a gift of eternal life where you will never, ever thirst again? As the music plays, I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet, and we'll have Brother Tar lead us in a song. Whatever God's spoken your heart about, please do business with the Lord. If you're here today and you're not saved, please seek one of us out. We can take the Bible and show you how you can be saved. If you're here today and you just need an encouragement, you're going through it spiritually, you're worn out, I tell you what, the answer could be for you to learn how to be a witness for Jesus Christ. I'm not even talking about memorizing all the verses and being eloquent in your speech, but like the Samaritan woman, share your story with anyone and everyone that'll listen. Get busy reaching the lost with the gospel of Jesus Christ. As the music plays, we'll start to sing.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
We'll sing one more verse. Whatever God spoke your heart about, please do.
Through death into life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us done no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strong. the light of his glory and grace.
All right, thank you so much for being here this morning. I want to encourage you to come back tonight if you can, 6 p.m. And then don't forget about the volleyball game night tonight in the gym right after the service. We'll have a good time with that. And also want to recognize our visitors. We have Keith and Beth Van Dyke. So glad that, if you would wave at folks, we're so glad to have them visiting. They're passing through. Just came from a wedding, and then they're going to be going back to Oregon soon, right? All right, so make sure you welcome them and let them know we're glad to have them here and pray for their safety as they head back home. But we're going to go ahead and be dismissed in prayer, and then Lord bless you. Have a great afternoon, and we'll see you tonight. Brother Gerber, would you mind praying for us?
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for the message, Lord. Let us be like the woman, and when our sins are forgiven, to go and tell others about you, Lord. Tell others about the gospel, and tell others of what you did in our lives, Lord, that saved us from our sin, Lord, and provided a pathway back to you, Lord. Lord, as we go from here to our homes, Lord, just keep us safe and help us to come back soon to continue to worship in your name. Thank you for all that you've given us. In your son's name, Jesus Christ, amen.